Thank you.
I received a copy of this book yesterday, and I had an opportunity to go through it somewhat superficially, but nevertheless, the key messages resonate very well. And you did reinforce them in your presentation, and of course, Harsh's exposition of what has happened in India is always an education in what is needed and how it actually works on the ground. So let me try and bring in some of the reflections on the common sense statements made in the book as well as today, and also bring in some of the perspectives from what is my area, that is health and public health. Clearly, we are really looking at soil health being linked to plant health being linked to human health, either directly or through consumption by animals and their consumption by humans. So again, this whole sequence from soil health to human health becomes very important in the context of agriculture and, of course, of malnutrition. Now, of course, the dimensions have been expanded, and rightly so, by the Sustainable Development Goals, which are bringing in the whole concept of planetary health, and then trying to tie all of that together. So in that context, if we actually look at what the problems of malnutrition are, the two dimensions of malnutrition that have been clearly highlighted, the two phases of malnutrition, are underweight, stunting, wasting, and of course, overweight and obesity, which have also been posed as threats. Not that these two are not linked together, they're physiologically quite connected too. But coming first to the whole issue of the economic analysis by McKinsey that has been presented, frightening as it is, but the emphasis on overweight and obesity perhaps is because the consequences of undernutrition are not estimated adequately in a single generation analysis, and the intergenerational aspects of it are not taken into account. And even the relation to overweight and obesity, which often arises in intrauterine and early childhood malnutrition, that link has not been taken into account. Therefore, I don't think we ought to be able to really divide this into watertight compartments. We ought to be able to really bring that connection much more holistically together. Starting with that connection of the intergenerational effects, clearly when there is a pregnant woman who is undernourished and the child growing in utero has to survive, and the brain is critical for that survival, the energy resources are preferentially diverted to the brain, the muscle mass is lean and is underdeveloped, so are some number of organs. And there is insulin resistance in the muscles, because then if you must try and preserve the blood glucose for the brain rather than for the muscles, and the child actually succeeds in being born alive. Stillbirth, of course, is a different issue, but this is a successful story of survival against great hardship. Now, in this hardship, you have compromises made, and those have consequences later on in life. The programming that occurs sometimes can actually make you programmed for an environment, anticipated future environment of deprivation. And therefore, when you actually enter even a relative, not necessarily in an environment of plenty, but of a relative sufficiency later in life, there is rebound adiposity, particularly in the age group of 2 to 12. And then you can actually become much more susceptible to cardiometabolic diseases like early adult diabetes and cardiovascular disease. But this again is seen as a single generation link. And when we talk about stunting, the big controversy that does come, of course, is many cases people have actually argued, pediatricians well-meaning, that if you actually have an underweight child who's been born small, adequate nutrition within the so-called normal range, that child is likely to become stunted, obese child, and therefore you ought to be able to really try and prevent that kind of so-called relative excess nutrition. But that militates against a public health concern that you really want the child's catch-up growth to be there, both for cognitive and physical development to be appropriate, without necessarily paying the penalty of metabolic maladaptation. So the question is, how do you actually ensure an appropriate diet with adequate physical activity combined during that period of growth, so that you can actually have the developmental disadvantage corrected with adequate physical and cognitive growth, but without necessarily paying that metabolic disadvantage penalty. So those are some of the questions that would come in. But again, this has been seen essentially as a single generation link, which is incorrect. Because when you look at a woman who is pregnant and carrying a female baby in the womb, that growing baby is also having developing eggs or oocytes. And these are not genetic changes, these are epigenetic changes, which are likely to result in differential expression of the genes. And the hypothalamus of the growing baby and the hypothalamus of the mother are now linked particularly into a state of co-adaptation, so that the placenta now sort of drives the energy flow from the mother's nutrition to the child. But you are also, in a sense, transferring a certain amount of information to the child, growing child, about the anticipated future environment. But these epigenetic changes are also affecting the growing eggs of the growing baby, of the yet-to-be-born baby and the yet-to-be-conceived children, her children, are now intergenerationally linked across three generations on whom the long shadow of malnutrition is cast. So therefore, the deprivation is really extensive, and therefore the economic costs are not really quantified. I'm not saying they cannot be quantified, but at least certain degree of, these externalities or whatever they are called, they should be really looked at beyond a single generation. So therefore, it becomes a rights issue as well. I mean, we are really compromising the rights of the yet-to-be-born child, but also of the future generations, of her right to bear healthy children later on. And there are also there's also a fair amount of research that paternal influences too can affect the epigenetic changes in the growing baby. So even paternal malnutrition can also sometimes affect, but it's the maternal malnutrition which is the much greater link. Now, in terms of overweight and obesity, again, the WHO Commission on Ending Childhood Obesity has come up with very strong recommendations in January, which is going up to the World Health Assembly in May. This calls for effective taxation of sugar-sweetened beverages, sugary drinks. It calls for marketing restrictions or bans on marketing to children, a number of things which are very appropriate. But the question is, how effectively will they be implemented? And that's where I'll reflect on some aspects of your book later on. I fully agree with you in terms of some of the statements that have been made about the nature of conditional cash transfers. And that is again illustrated by research on behavioral economics. For example, in New York, there was front of calorie labeling, where they put in the amount of calories in front of each food product, marketing versus food product. And they thought that consumer education would very much help in making them choose the right product. When they did it, when they compared New York and Newark, they found that indeed the consumer knowledge had gone up substantially, but the consumption patterns in terms of overall calories did not change. But when they did a disaggregated analysis, they found that the lower socioeconomic groups in New York actually started consuming more calories because for them, it was bigger bang for the buck to buy higher calories for a single dollar. Now, therefore, the big challenge is how do you make healthier foods the more affordable foods? So unless that affordability barrier is crossed, mere conditional cash transfer is not going to succeed. Firstly, the availability and access are an issue, and affordability is an issue. The natural tendency is to gravitate towards unhealthy foods which are plentifully being marketed. So these are some of the barriers that do need to be looked into in the environment. Now, in terms of the overall issue of where we are in terms of our food security, which now has to transition into nutrition security rather than just energy security, the question of staples versus non-staples comes in. And the high prices of non-staples, the low production of non-staples becomes a big challenge in this country. And sometimes over-dependence on staples, particularly in the highly polished and defiberized state, can be a problem for growing diabetes and the cardiovascular disease in this country. And therefore, the whole sequence of crop diversity to dietary diversity with interposed food processing systems as well as consumer marketing systems, all of that will have to be looked into in totality if we are really trying to look at nutrition security in the larger dimension of health. I agree entirely with the contention in the book that we ought to be really looking at diet-based interventions and programs rather than purely supplement-based programs. I agree with it's easy for scientists, particularly nutrition scientists and biomedical scientists and health researchers, to fall into the trap of gathering evidence from what they know best in terms of randomized clinical trials of a particular single intervention, nutrient intervention, and then forget the big picture. And then for evidence-based guidelines to emerge, saying that this is the only evidence we have, forgetting that lack of evidence of benefit is not evidence of lack of benefit. The fact that we do not have evidence is that we have been ignoring policy-relevant research. So therefore, that whole element has also to be looked into, and I think what you've stated in your book is absolutely appropriate. Now, in terms of the greater emphasis on nutrition-sensitive interventions, I fully agree. The problem, of course, is that they're often multisectoral, and how one does one bring in that multisectoral coordination in a country becomes absolutely important. But that is absolutely important if we have to have nutritional security in the longer run. But where I have a certain degree of divergence, I wouldn't say divergence, but I would like to extend it and challenge you a little bit on that particular aspect of the book, where you talk in terms of global governance and rightly say that some of the non-state actors are getting in much greater influence in terms of determining some of the policies. And you believe that multilateral agencies ought to be really brought together in order to provide a good policy direction through international agreements, and how multilateral agencies themselves can be made to behave in a much better manner, to be relatively free from some of the influence of the dominant private sector and other non-state actors, is by getting member states to act. You in fact say that how do we actually get the multilateral agencies to behave better? The answer is disarmingly simple: get the member states to do it. It is somewhat of a touching trust, I must say, because how does one actually get the member states to act better, not only in the euphoric moment of a UN conclave, but afterwards in terms of effective implementation? Now, Harsh has very clearly pointed out that the very nobly intended Food Security Act has had enormous hurdles even after the adoption by the parliament. So we know from Tobacco Control Act that the Framework Convention on Tobacco Control was one of the best public health treaties ever, but the implementation has been so poor in this country and many other countries. So how does one actually get the member states also to act? And again, it is not as though the pernicious influence of some of the non-state actors stops at the UN Assembly. It actually pervades much more into the countries. And how does one actually bring that into play? So these are some of the questions that need to be answered very clearly. And there, the surprising omission in the book is the role of the civil society. The role of the civil society in order to act as a conscience keeper, to keep the member states accountable, and thereby the member states being accountable to the larger UN agreements, I think that is the important element. You may counter by saying that my trust in the civil society is touching and naive, because civil society is often relatively weak. And with all the civil society actors in play in India, we still have not managed to get the Food Security Act properly implemented. That is because even the civil society, like academics, have been functioning in silos. I think the SDGs provides us a great and grand opportunity for bringing many civil society actors together. It is impossible to think of nutrition nowadays without looking at poverty reduction, without looking at health, without looking at gender, without looking at the other goals on life in forests, life under the oceans, and many other issues that we are really, or energy security for that matter. Because if we are wanting in a situation, and the whole environment, climate change offers us that challenge. We know, for example, that the demand for food is going to rise by 14% per decade because of urbanization, population growth, and increasing income levels. We also know that food production is going to fall by 2% per decade, principally because of climate change, and that South Asia and Africa are going to be the most vulnerable areas. With every 1 degree centigrade rise in temperature, we're going to see a 10 degree fall in food production, particularly of staples, but also of non-staples. So how are we going to tie up all of these together? And this is where connectivity has to be really looked at. If I look at the health angle, for example, food systems, we are not yet in that state, but we are very much advancing there. The whole factory-style livestock production of meat, poultry, and others. Well, from the health point of view, it is a threat to cardiovascular disease, diabetes, cancers. From the point of view of climate change, 50% of the methane emissions are emitted from the livestock. From the point of view of food insecurity, there's a huge grain diversion to the animals who are being fed. They're also water intensive, heavily water intensive. But equally importantly, and not widely appreciated, is that this is also a conveyor belt for infectious diseases. In the last 50 years, we have had several new infectious disease outbreaks. About 70% of them are zoonotic, transmitted from animals to humans. This is not because animals have become suddenly malevolent towards human beings. It is because we have established production systems in which there are huge amount of animals being bred in captivity. We have deforested in order to grow grains for them, particularly corn, and corn, soya, and others. And then we establish a conveyor belt between viruses and vectors hitherto confined in forest areas into captive veterinary population, where the viruses can mutate and multiply, and then have an easy entry into the neighboring human habitat. So it is this ecological disaster that's being created by, and therefore we are really looking at also a world in which the environment is now threatening agriculture and food systems because of environmental degradation from multiple sources. And agriculture and food systems themselves are threatening the environment in many ways, and we need to really resolve this contradiction much better. Talking of tobacco, when has the FAO taken a stand against 4 million hectares of arable land being devoted to a killer crop as against nutrient crops that are required? So why has that stand against the industry not been taken? So these are some of the challenging questions that we need to ask, but they can also provide the platform for a number of civil society groups to come together and raise the collective voice much more effectively. Otherwise, as long as we still campaign in silos, we are not going to do it. And we have to emphasize the core benefits of acting together and merging across the sustainable development goals. And I think that is going to be one of the critical areas in which between 2015 and 2030 we ought to be really acting together. And therefore, I believe, Harsh said there's no happy ending. But I recall what Martin Luther King said, change does not roll in on the wheels of inevitability, it calls for continuous struggle. So I believe there is a need for continuous struggle, but the need is to unite as many interested groups as possible, align actors, amplify advocacy, and accelerate action. Thank you.